Hello, Robert Bastian here. Recently, I had a patient that I had treated for R-CPD tell me that she felt that I hadn't explained to her enough about the possible complications. She happened to be someone who experienced laryngospasm, and I didn't know that it had happened to her. And so I thought to myself, well, let me sit down and make a little video about all of the complications that we've encountered over the caseload of about 865 patients. So here we go, just an informal discussion, and 865 people, not going chart by chart, but just consulting with our data manager and database and the things that I am pulling out of my head. So here we go. Before we do complications, though, a quick review of the disorder itself, RCPD, retrograde cricopharyngeus dysfunction, really miserable disorder. It's defined syndromically by four primary symptoms, and I've got an asterisk after each of these because this is a spectrum disorder, and so sometimes people want to be literal and exact, and I can't do that because, for example, can't burp. Every now and again, a person says, well, once or twice a week, I have a little micro burp. It's unexpected and I can't harness it. And so they think, well, maybe that means I don't have it because I have those couple little micro burps. No, it's basically you can't burp to relieve symptoms that of a lot of air buildup. So can't burp, gurgling noises. A few say it's kind of quiet and internal, but most people say it's audible at least a few feet away when it's at its worst, and some people say across a large room. Bloating is primarily abdominal and can be with actual distension of the abdomen. We use pregnancy as an analogy, and some people have chest pressure and even low neck symptoms. So bloating, and then the flatulence is almost universal. Occasionally, there's a person who says, I don't have much of that. And they're usually people who do the air vomiting. They gag themselves to stay ahead of the accumulation of the air. Now, lesser but quite common symptoms are painful hiccups, nausea, especially after eating large amounts, a feeling of shortness of breath. If I'm very symptomatic, it's like I can't take a deep breath because there's no room in there. Hypersalivation, I get a little nauseated, a little uncomfortable, and my mouth kind of waters, and then I'm swallowing extra, and it just makes it all worse. And then constipation. Well, we have to distinguish between complications and early effects of Botox. So there are some early effects that might be a bit unpleasant in a small percentage, but those are not complications. Those are just early effects. And all of these early effects are transient. They are the most obvious at the beginning, and as we work some weeks into the Botox cycle, they subside. So let's talk about early effects that are sort of outlier at the end of the spectrum. Excessive burping doesn't happen in most people, but there are just a few who say, boy, I'm ready to stop burping now. I think I've caught up for my whole life. Every time I swallow, I burp. Or a few people have said, I take a deep breath and air goes into my esophagus, and then when I exhale, a burp happens. Again, transient on the way through to a good result, excessive burping. Most people, it's fun and it's funny and it's so relieving of all the symptoms, but in that very small subset, excessive burping. Swallowing weirdness happens in most people, and once they get the hang of it, it's not a big deal. They just, whenever they're eating solid food, they keep liquid nearby and they eat their food and it sort of hangs in this limp zone and they just quickly take a sip and that takes care of it. But a very small subset will say, I had to do smoothies and liquids for the first few weeks because it was a little bit off-putting trying to swallow solids. So again, not most people, but a few. Sour burps, a few have complained of that. And that's because not only is air coming up, but a little bit of stomach contents. Few people have said their reflux. Reflux is common in RCPD, of course, and when you evacuate the pillow of air, because now you can burp, so that pillow of air comes out, well, now the liquid stomach contents can come higher in the esophagus, and so heartburn can be worse again transiently. All of these things are temporary in the first few weeks, and we're on our way to much better. So now we're to complications. And again, this is not a chart by chart by chart, so I could have missed a few here, but what I did was we went to the database, I went to my data manager, PA Wingo, and then I took out of my head, and this is the list that we together made up. Chipped tooth, anytime a person has endoscopy, esophagus, larynx, bronchoscopy, there is a chance of a chipped tooth because there's a little pressure on these upper teeth. It's really uncommon. We use a tooth guard, a lot of care, but in that person who has large upper teeth, can't open the mouth, a short neck, there's a little risk of this chipped tooth. So in the many, many procedures I do across a year, I do a lot more than just RCPD. A couple times a year, or a very small number, we may have a chipped tooth. And what I mean is, usually it's a little roughened area and we just smooth it off and it's not a problem. But there is a very tiny risk to teeth. If your jaw is normal, your anatomy is basically normal, it's a vanishingly rare kind of a thing. Sensitive tooth, I've only had this once in an entire career, a person from out of country who said he had little microelectric shocks. It wasn't that the shocks themselves were a big deal, he wasn't taking pain medicine, but he was really focused on this because it shouldn't be happening and he needed an explanation and it was extremely troubling to him. And it went away after a couple of months. I have no idea what that's about. Has never happened before or since. One individual, my caseload, all-time most difficult anatomy, middle-aged woman, no jaw, very tiny lower jaw, large upper teeth, small mouth opening. I worked the hardest to get the view in her of anyone before or since, and I put a little scrape on the back wall of the throat. She got what's called cellulitis infection, some fever. She took a few days of antibiotics and no harm came to her, but that was a definite complication. Then anesthesia complications. We have laryngospasm on emerging from anesthesia, which is a very different thing from laryngospasm in an awake person who's living their life. So first we'll talk about the one episode of laryngospasm emerging from anesthesia that was a very strong laryngospasm, actually an out-of-country patient also. And so it creates a lot of excitement. No harm came to him. No hospitalization, but it's a sort of a memory. And in my career, I've seen plenty of laryngospasm on emerging from anesthesia, but just maybe a half a dozen cases where it was quite severe, such as it was in this man. None of the patients in my entire caseload have come to any harm, but again, it creates excitement. And that's laryngospasm upon emerging from anesthesia. Very different thing from laryngospasm at home or so forth. So tongue laceration, now this is the one where I'm actually a little embarrassed, but I had another patient with very difficult anatomy. And of course I'm working and focused and trying to get the view through the scope. And I didn't notice that the tongue got caught between the scope and the teeth. And so she had a laceration. No stitches needed, no permanent damage, but I'm sure quite sore and embarrassing for me. It's one of those things, my bad, and again, it shouldn't happen. It's one person out of 865 and one too many. And then finally, laryngospasm after completing the procedure and going home and living their lives in the next few weeks. I knew about two where laryngospasm was an issue in those people because it came to my attention and it was very frightening to them. And I consulted with PA Wingo, and there have been a handful of others who contacted her, and I didn't realize that it was reported to her. And she said they just basically shrugged. They needed an explanation. They must have been mild laryngospasms because she said they weren't upset or bothered in any way, but these three where the laryngospasms were a little bit more intense. Now, laryngospasm, again, not dangerous. I have created a teaching video. You can go to Laryngopedia and find that video if you think you might be that one out of 300 people who might have laryngospasm also. I didn't think to mention it as a potential complication because it just is so uncommon. But that is the list that I can come up with, and I just don't like being in the circumstance where any patient thinks that I haven't told them all the things that I should have told them, and so that's why I decided to just make this video. And so if you're one of my patients who's had this done and there's a complication you had that I didn't mention, please contact me and let me know, because I do want people to know all of the potential issues. The vast majority, it's a very smooth, it's a little weird at the beginning with the burping and the swallowing, but it's absolutely not an issue for them. So there you have my discussion, and thank you for listening.